Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. This is Health Up on your TV station, Elevate, and we are glad that you're joining us tonight. This is where we do Advancing Kingdom Lifestyle. And this is your weekly program or our weekly program, which is Health Up, where we'll delve on, you know, important health matters and aspects to improve our health. And like we keep saying, we want to bring in new knowledge, change our attitudes, and be able to bring in new skills as it were, and where possible. And we believe that this has been of help to all of us. So karibuni sana, and we are glad that you're tuning in. Kindly follow us on our social media platforms. We are on Facebook Live, Elevate TV. If a friend or so is calling you and asking you where do you get Elevate TV, it's also Pang Elevate. You can search for the signal. Of course, varies from place to place. And also live on our Facebook, on our, you know, YouTube channel, Elevate TV in capitals. And we are glad that you're joining us this evening as we discuss matters tonight. We're going to be getting on a very important and a very crucial topic in the matters of nutrition, but you're going to look at exclusive breastfeeding. Of course, it has an adjective, exclusive, and you're going to be looking at all that. So what is exclusive breastfeeding? What is the importance? And we believe that this is of great benefit, you know, to all of us. This evening, I'm joined by my guest, Faith Gitahi, and Lucy Mwimi, and we are glad that you people found time to be able to join us. Lucy is a nutritionist, both with experience, public and private sector, and she's been on practice and currently, you know, working as a livelihood manager with Kenya Red Cross Society. And we are glad that you actually found time and, you know, saved some time to be together with us. Yes. You can say hi to our viewers tonight or this evening as we start this particular conversation.
Hello, viewers. Thank you for joining us. We look forward to a great time together.
Thank you, Lucy. And on my left, joined by one, Faith Gitahi. As you can see, she's holding a baby over there. We're going to be knowing that as a baby or a dummy, or, you know. And Faith Gitahi is an advocate, you know, for breastfeeding, right? And a lactation, you know, manager, and one who is really passionate. Of course, she has a background as a consultant in nutrition matters, as a consultant nutritionist, and really exposed, you know, in matters nutrition, and formerly also working as a deputy chief nutrition officer in the Ministry of Health. And we are really glad that, you know, Faith, you're finding time to join us, and as we discuss about, you know, exclusive breastfeeding with our viewers. I just say hi to our viewers, you know, and that will be a blessing to
Good
us.
Good evening, viewers. I look forward to discussing more about this baby with me here, how we should take care of it so that we have a stronger nation tomorrow. Thank you. Kalibuni.
Right. So keep in touch. Elevate, Health Up. This is the place to be at this particular hour. So probably would, you know, just go direct into this and, you know, getting probably to Lucy. Why breastfeeding? And of course, this is the context of breastfeeding a baby. You know, I hope all of us really understand this. So why breastfeeding and not any other foods? Why, what is the importance?
Okay, great. Thank you so much, Onesmus.
Right.
That's a very pertinent question. More so because we are living in an era where people seem to have choices and options.
Oh, yeah.
A young mother can make a decision to feed their baby on anything else that is not breast milk. So tonight we will be discussing on why we should encourage that mother to choose breastfeeding.
Yes.
Against every other choice available today.
Yes.
And just to say that there are many benefits that come with breastfeeding your baby.
Yes.
Both to your baby.
Yes.
Yourself.
Right.
Your family and the community at large.
Yes.
So maybe I'll briefly just mention, you know, each of those four categories and how they benefit from breastfeeding.
Right.
And I'm sure that will motivate our viewers and everybody else out there to, you know, pay attention to what we're discussing tonight. To begin with, for your baby, we all know that a baby is born with a low immunity and they're not readily able to fight diseases and pathogens, you know, after birth. So breast milk comes in handy to support the baby's immunity to grow and to become stronger.
Very
then
good.
They are able to fight diseases and pathogens.
Right.
We also have the baby's brain developing between 0 to 2 years.
Yes.
And it's a window of opportunity. And if a baby does not gain optimal brain development between that window of opportunity, they then lose it like permanently. Not to say that they will not you know, survive, really,
true.
But they may not become what they were meant to become in terms of their mental capacity.
Exactly.
Breast milk comes in handy to support the baby to have optimal brain development.
Brain good development, yes.
Then also the baby is able to grow appropriately because the milk has all the baby needs, you know, within the first 6 months of birth.
Absolutely.
Moving to the mother, we know about the many cases of cancer reported today. Oh. The mother's health is also quite impacted by breastfeeding. And we are talking about the likes of breast cancer. The mother is able to evade that.
Yes.
To more withstand, you know, the challenge of breast cancer infection if they're breastfeeding properly, and also the cervical cancers and all that. To the family, the baby is more bonded. They can learn to
breastfeed.
To breastfeed and to yes. find comfort and security, yes. mm. you know, with the mother. And we are now encouraging fathers to also participate in breastfeeding. And for as long as a father is participating in breastfeeding the baby, giving the mother the right environment, the right kind of support.
Oh, I was just about to ask how do they breastfeed.
Yeah, sure. I'm sure that's a question
right,
quite
yeah.
a number of us yes. will readily ask.
Yes.
Giving the mother the right kind of support, psychosocially
yes.
and all,
right.
To make sure that the mother is comfortable and is provided for. And the baby can be able to sense that. And they also develop a bond, not just with the mother,
but
also
with
the father. And by and large, with the rest of the family. Because I've seen families where the baby is breastfeeding and all the children are also like near there.
Yeah, exactly.
And, you know, smiling at the baby.
Yes.
And that brings a lot of warmth in the family. What about the community? If a community were to completely ignore breastfeeding today and grow children that were just fed on anything else available to them, what do you see that community becoming in the near future? They are likely to have even the lowest of the capacities. I won't mention, of course, any career here, but they are likely to lack even the lowest of the competences that are required to grow a community. But look at a community that embraces breastfeeding and supports their own children to breastfeed properly. They are likely to bring forth a community that is full of geniuses, I mean, so to say.
And
that community will actually be very strong in terms of economic empowerment and in very many other ways.
Right.
So there's also a benefit when a child is, children are breastfed properly to the community.
Wow. And probably, you know, something else is also that this breast milk is already available.
Yes.
And it's also, you know, so to say cheap. I don't know if that's a profit.
It's actually free.
It's actually free,
yes.
so to say. So
yes.
It's
affordable.
It's affordable, yes. It's something accessible and something affordable.
Affordable,
wow.
Yes.
Those are immense benefits, you know, that you're getting from, you know, breast milk.
Yeah.
And probably now adding it on an adjective and talking about exclusive breastfeeding, with now coupling with what Lucy is saying, Faith, when you talk about exclusive breastfeeding, what is this, and why do you want to encourage, you know, mothers to exclusive breastfeeding? Of course, bringing into us when, at up to what age, and such things is.
Okay, viewers, when we talk about exclusive breastfeeding, is breastfeeding the baby without giving anything else, not even water, except drops of medicine that may be prescribed by the doctor, and that is from birth to 6 months. That is what we refer to as exclusive
breastfeeding, including water.
Not even water. You don't give water. So it is just breastfeeding the baby without giving anything else except medicine that is prescribed, vitamins that are prescribed by the doctor.
Yes.
So not what the mother will prescribe.
Right.
And that is from birth to 6 months. The importance of this exclusive breastfeeding, Lucy has mentioned some of them. That baby only requires that breast milk because it has all the growth factors and all the nutrients the baby requires to grow and to develop. Remember, we want this brain to develop to capacity. So in the first 6 months, the breast milk has everything that the baby requires to grow. Even that water. Even the water itself is there.
Even when they hiccup and we
even they just need that water that is in that breast milk.
The water in the breast milk.
Oh, yes. And it is in the right nutrients, the quantities are right, and that's why we don't want this baby to be given other things. Because remember, the gut, the intestines are not fully developed. So in the breast milk, there are certain factors that help maturation of the gut. So the baby requires that breast milk to mature the gut, so that by the time it reaches 6 months, it's able to now start other foods because the gut is ready to digest. And this will have been gotten from the breast milk. The other thing is that within that period of 6 months, a mother may not get pregnant. So it is also another form of family planning.
Okay.
Yes, if she is doing it on demand.
On demand.
Demand meaning that she breastfeeds and she's not told that it is at this time that you should breastfeed. She just, anytime when the baby wants, she gives the breast. And she does it during the day and during the night.
And at night, yes. Mm.
That means that she will be catered for in terms of hormone levels. The hormonal levels for bringing ovulation will be suppressed because of the production of the breast milk. And breast milk is produced on demand. When a baby demands, then the hormones react and release and the breast make the milk.
Okay.
So it is a supply and demand.
Supply and demand.
Supply and demand law. And therefore, we say that let the baby not be given anything else.
Okay.
Before 6 months, because we don't want to have issues of constipation.
Yes.
We've had babies being given pumpkins, bananas, uji.
Uji.
The first 2 weeks of life. Others are given salt, water, glucose, water.
Because they have stomach pain.
Now, who said that this baby has pain? Has the doctor told you the baby is suffering from anything? So the fact that the baby is curling itself doesn't mean that it is having pains. So you don't need to give these other things, because sometimes they go in and they are the ones that clog the gut. They block the intestines. We have had babies even going to theater in 3 months, because already that part of intestines is blocked by the pumpkins and the popos that were given, and it has to be cut and removed. So it is that serious, and therefore let the baby be given what it requires in the 6 months.
Wow.
Yes.
So what we're basically saying is that it goes beyond what we think and beyond what we see.
Exactly.
And you're also telling us that a baby is not a small adult.
It is not a small adult. And also that the tummy is so small. At birth, I think if I quote and say, Bano, I don't know how what you call it in English.
Right.
That that thing that people, the boys,
yes.
That is the size of the stomach.
Oh.
And then that is at birth. You start giving us a whole half a glass of uji or milk or whatever.
You
Where
are
you putting it? Yes. You're actually going to pursue your tumbo. You're going to disturb it. You're going to introduce things that are not right, because breast milk has right what we call bifidofactors, the right bacteria that help the gut to mature, as I said earlier. But when you give other things, you're actually eroding. And sometimes babies have been given pumpkins and popos, and then they poop. You see blood because you're actually eroding.
You have actually eroded.
Yes.
Our viewers, we are talking and discussing this evening exclusive breastfeeding. And of course, this is with the babies. And we are glad that you're joining us kindly in your tune in on this. In the next few minutes before 1 hour is over, you're going to have gained a lot of, you know, information and updates on what is right. We are saying a baby is not a small adult. We need to give them time to mature, time to grow, and time to have their organs developed.
Yes.
Lucy, we are talking about, you know, day zero, so to say, up to 6 months, because
yes,
that's what Faith is bringing up. But after how long after delivery? Because one can always start, you know, at 30 minutes. I don't know whether it's practical start after 2 days or three, but basically the question is, how soon should one initiate, you know, breastfeeding? And of course, in this context, exclusive breastfeeding, because now we are moving from just breastfeeding to exclusive breastfeeding, you know, after birth, how soon should one basically, you know, initiate it, and what are the importance?
Thank you, Onesmus. That's a great question. And maybe before I answer your question, I'll start by telling mothers and fathers that they have the say.
Hey.
A lot of times, we are not aware of to what extent we have a say.
Okay.
And as you do your birth plan, as you organize where to get your baby and with whom, remember that you have a say as to what happens to your baby immediately they are born. The reason I'm saying this is because I've met quite a number of mothers who will say that when I gave birth to my baby, I was supposed to rest. So the baby was taken away and I was also kept aside. So in that kind of a scenario, we are not even talking about an initiation, because the baby and the mother are kept away. So we start by ensuring that we give instructions. Immediately my baby is born, let my baby be with me. That's called rooming in. Very important, because it's now during rooming in that you start your responsibilities of motherhood, your responsibilities of fatherhood. We do not normally take a break, that the mother is too tired to even breastfeed their baby.
You know that's where I was heading to, because
yes,
many times when a baby is born,
yes,
and it's actually even you know what you call normal delivery, where
yes,
both of them are normal, but
yes,
you call the natural normal
yes
delivery.
Yes.
The baby is taken away, the mother is tired.
Exactly.
The mother needs to go and bathe,
yes,
and relax and rest, get some uji.
Yes.
You know, and meanwhile the baby is kept aside. So you're also sending a message to the health workers.
Yes.
Because
I
hear you as an advocate for this mother and for this baby.
Yes.
You are sending a message that that practice is not right.
Yes.
The mother is tired. Who said the mother is tired? This is what the mother has been waiting for.
A mother doesn't get tired when it comes to the baby. They can be tired with a lot of other things in this life.
I wish I would tell you to say that louder and louder again. But anyway,
a mother will never be tired when it comes to their children.
Wow.
And the welfare of
the welfare of
their children. The child can be 69 years old.
Mm. It's still the mother's.
The mother will still be energetic enough to take care of the welfare of that child.
So child in that context, of course. So get back to this rooming in.
I'm back to rooming in.
Get back to it.
So mothers, fathers need to understand that they have a say. And that say doesn't come when the baby comes. Mm-hmm. You have to organize early enough and make sure that you explain to your midwife, to whoever will be delivering your baby, that for you, you will desire to have your baby with you.
Wow.
Now, the other bit is that you need to also understand the benefits of early initiation. And actually, the government commands or instructs that it's policy that rooming in has to be done within the first one. I mean, initiation has to be done within 1 hour.
First 1 hour, yes.
The first 1 hour after delivery.
After delivery, yes.
And so a mother, again, and you as a healthcare worker out there have a say. You have what it takes to support our mothers who may not understand this, to be able to do early initiation, and that is within the first 1 hour. And so I've got a photograph here, and we have a mother who has just given birth. And as you can see, the cord has not even been cut.
The cord has not even been cut, yes, because there are some scissors there.
As you can see,
yes, there's some cramping.
They've clamped, but they've not cut it yet.
Yes, yes.
So what this means is that immediately the baby was born, they were placed on the mother's chest. And this is supposed to be done in such a way that the baby's skin and the mother's skin come into contact. In fact, there's a very nice video that we cannot show tonight of a baby that was placed there and they found their way to the breast.
We will have to find you again and bring us that video.
That video has to be watched here. No problem.
I'm telling you.
You know, and what they advise is that you as the midwife should not wipe the hands of the baby. Mm. As you pop them out of the womb and clean them up, you leave the hands unwiped. Mm. So that the fluid, the amniotic fluid that remains on the hands is going to be guiding the baby towards the breast. So the baby finds their way to the breast. At birth,
wow,
the baby has what
they
it takes to
climb.
Do that.
They actually climb
They climb on that chest until they find the breast.
And these are scientific matters.
Yes.
These are not myths.
Proven.
These are not
matters.
These are not Karumanzira, whatever that means.
Yes. They are not Adabdakarabi. I mean, it's real life.
Even
you as a baby who would have done that if you were given the chance, you know.
And don't force it on the breast. It will find the breast.
The
baby will find the breast.
Yes. Because like Faith explained already, there are some natural triggers.
Yes.
For breastfeeding that connect the baby to the breast.
Yeah.
So the brain will actually, there's a smell on the breast that will actually attract the baby. And as the baby moves, the amniotic fluid is also guiding them towards where the breast is, and the baby finds their way there. And that ought to be done within the first 1 hour. The reason being, number one, it will help the baby to warm up. Because skin to skin, and the baby is getting the natural warmth from the mother. The baby will also be able to breathe well because they are actually already connecting with not just the world, but they are disconnecting from the mother's system and they are connecting with the world, but without a very like a abrupt detach. Mm-hmm. You know, they are gradually now seeping into the other world of you know, where we live. Huh?
Exactly.
That also helps us to get our breast milk you know, flowing early enough.
Wow.
Because the baby needs that. Why? Mm-hmm. This is what we call meconium. And meconium is the blood stool that the baby poops after birth. And that is supposed to be cleared within some hours after birth.
After birth.
And the breast milk is supposed to come in colostrum. The first milk, which is very rich in vitamin A, has some factors, the purgative factors that help to expel that meconium
yes.
And to also prepare the system. To
actually come out within the first 2 hours, yes.
Exactly. Mm. To start preparing the baby to start now feeding on you know, external food,
external
the breast
food,
milk,
yes,
and to start you know, internalizing and you know, assimilating that into the system, you know. So it's very important that the baby gets that as early as within the first 1 hour to make sure that they do not lose any opportunity to get the right footing as they start their lives around.
Basically, you're saying we can actually delay between second stage of labor and third stage of labor because that's where, you know, the midwife will come in.
Yes.
It can actually be delayed because in that sense where the clamping has been done, but the cutting has not even been done, that's now within the delivery of the baby. That's what we call the second stage. Before we get to deliver the placenta, we already have the baby. We can actually give the mother, you know, a few minutes or such to be able to, you know, begin boarding and have the boarding with the baby before now finally we complete and finalize the whole delivery, as it were.
Yes, actually the process of delivery should be completed when the baby has already been placed on the chest of the mother. We do not wait until we've detached the cord, we've cleaned the baby up.
There's no hurry that you are going to wash the baby or bathe the baby. There's no hurry.
The issue
that baby can stay even unwashed for 2 days.
And actually, it protects the skin.
That mucus that comes out from the womb protects that baby.
Yes.
And the other reason why she was saying about the skin-to-skin touch.
Yes, please.
There is that colonization of bacteria of the baby and the mothers. By the way, babies can smell and say, this is not my mother.
Exactly.
I'm telling
you. So if they are placed on the skin,
they'll
already start colonizing together. The bacteria of the baby and the mother colonizes.
Yes.
But if this baby is taken by somebody else,
the
baby's bacteria colonizes with that other person, not the mother.
Not the mother.
That is why it should be placed skin to skin contact.
Skin to skin contact.
Yeah.
Viewers, I believe that this is something very interesting, and also not only viewers in terms of, you know, where being a patient or being a client in a hospital, this is also a message to our health workers. I know probably these are not things that came out, you know, in the courses of our training, as it were, but every experience is a learning experience, and we continue learning and picking up the new things that we should do, because we are doing this for the benefit of the mother and the benefit of the baby. Keep watching. This is Elevate Health Up. Numbers going down on your screen. Keep sharing this kindly. If it is benefiting you, why not share with your friend? Why not share with your brother or sister? It's of a much benefit. And you know, Faith, Lucy just brought us through initiation and the importance, you know, talk about this boarding and the like. But now the question comes in. I know we just about to go for a short break, but the question comes in: how do we attach, or how, you know, the baby might find their way, you know, into the breast.
Yeah.
What if not? Is there a way of helping the baby, and how do we do the attachment?
Yeah.
Just briefly.
Once our mother now settles and the delivery process is over, we have what we call positioning and attaching the baby.
True.
And there are certain key factors that we must look at. I'm going to demonstrate with this baby.
Absolutely.
There are 4 key points on positioning, and there are 4 key points on attaching.
Kindly viewers, let's walk step by step. I think these are some of the important details that you need to carry home. 4 points and 4?
4 key points on positioning.
4 key points on positioning.
And 4 key points on attachment.
And 4 key points on attachment.
Because if you don't get these 4 key points of each, this is where other problems arise.
Wow.
Issues of a crying baby, issues of my baby does not want my breast,
not enough milk,
they come in because of the
positioning and attachment.
I'll start with the viewers, I'll start with the attachment. A baby who is born, the neck is normally very loose.
Yes.
It can turn to almost 180 degrees. And therefore, we don't want these babies to suckle when their heads are on the side. So the first thing you do is to make sure that the hand and the body is in line.
Wow. Head and the body is in line.
Head and body is in line. So we don't want this head to be looking sideways like this, and the body is facing up.
On the other side.
So the head and the body must be in line like
head
that.
Head and body in line.
So when it is in line like this, that is one key point.
One.
The next
key point number one.
Yes, key point number one. The next one, we have seen babies who are being breastfed when they are on the lap. So we want this baby to come closer. So the baby is brought closer, and this is where we say tummy to tummy. So tummy, ya baby na ya mama and the mother are together.
Yes.
You can see this baby is facing me now.
Yes.
Then the other thing is support this baby. You support the whole body. That is the third one.
The third one. So we move from the first one.
We move from the first one where we align the body.
Yes.
We align the body.
Then we do tummy to tummy.
We bring it closer.
Yes.
Tummy to tummy.
Yes.
Then we support the whole back.
The whole back.
And from that point, you can see the baby is near my breast.
Yes.
So the nose and the baby, my nipple and the breast.
And the breast.
The nipple of my breast is now facing the nose. So the baby is ready to open the mouth and receive the breast. That is positioning.
That's positioning.
That is positioning.
That's positioning.
Now, when it attaches, because it has come close, now it can attach.
There are, and again, four key points you must look at.
Four key points after positioning.
Yes. Now, four key points on attaching. That you will say, my baby is well attached to my breast.
Four key points on attaching.
Yes. So when the baby has come and now it has attached itself, there are four things you must look at.
True.
We normally demonstrate like this. Viewers, if you can see clearly, my two fingers are wide open. We call this the fish mouth. We call it the fish mouth. So the mouth of the baby must be wide open. That is number one. The mouth of the baby must be wide open. So if that baby didn't open the mouth widely, don't give that breast. Because it will not attach well. It might attach and start just suckling with the lips.
With the lips.
And the baby normally suckles with the tongue. Hey. It doesn't suckle with the lips. So mouth wide open.
That's
when it is mouth wide open, then the baby brings the tongue out to grasp now the nipple. So what happens? You'll see the lower lip is turned outwards. That is point number two.
Point number two, because first one is mouth wide open.
Mouth wide open, lower lip turned
downwards.
Downwards.
Yes.
Then on the upper side, the upper lip, when you look at the upper side of the lip when it is attached, you'll see the black area of the breast, more of it called the areola.
Areola, yes.
You'll see a lot of areola on the upper side.
Huh?
That is number three.
That's number three.
And the last one, when the baby properly attaches, the chin, this now is assuming this is the chin because this is the lower lip.
Yes.
The chin of the baby is closer and attaches itself to
the breast.
To the breast.
Hold that faith, because I believe we need to do a recap on that, and we need to bring in the 4 points and the 4 points after the after positioning. Viewers, we need to go for a short break, and we need you to remain on Elevate TV as we just take a short break briefly, and we'll be back after the break. Keep it Elevate.